the President and Chair of the Governing Council of the Institute of Directors Nigeria, Dr. Mrs. Ije Chidemma. Chair, Women Directors Development Committee, Otumba Mrs. Debola Oshibogun. Keynote speakers, members of the Institute, honored guests, ladies and gentlemen. I'm honored to join you at this 2022 edition of the Institute of Directors Women Directors Conference. And I thank the Governing Council of the Institute for the very kind invitation. The theme of the conference, Facing Forward, the Evolving Nature of Boards in a Rapidly Changing World, as well as the topics for discussion, will cover a very wide remit. And looking at the caliber of speakers, you certainly have a rich and busy day ahead. I have chosen to speak to a small but I think important sub-aspect of the theme. This is the question of female representation and participation in leadership, but more pointedly, to make the case for effective and balanced female representation in leadership. I think a question that always seems to pop up in conversations on the subject is, do women do better than men in the same positions, or are men better performers on the job than women? The arguments will go on and on, but let's look at some of the evidence. I have some anecdotal and personal experience, and there are a few empirical researches. When I was appointed Attorney General in Lagos in 1999, one of the major problems with the judiciary was the perception of corruption. We conducted a study of 200 lawyers who practice in the high courts of Lagos State. 89% of them said that judges were notoriously corrupt. We then started a reform which involved compensation and discipline and several other things, but also a deliberate headhunting of female lawyers, many of whom had no previous courtroom experience, but were outstanding academics, corporate lawyers, and solicitors. When we announced our list of new appointees of 52 judges, it turns out that 71% of them were female. So as of 2001, 71% of judges in Lagos State were female. In 2007, when we conducted yet another survey of 200 lawyers asking the same question on perception of corruption in the judiciary as we had asked in 1999, this time 0% said judges in the High Court of Lagos State were corrupt, 0%. Despite the fact that many of the judges had not been in practice, they had turned out to be easily amongst the most outstanding judges in the country. Now, there are many variables here, and we cannot say categorically that women make better and more honest judges than men. But the Lagos judiciary has shown that there may be a point in thinking that way. Well, let's look at some other quite reliable studies. The Center for Economic Policy and the World Economic Forum published an analysis on the handling of coronavirus in 194 countries. The study showed that countries led by women had, and I quote, systematically and significantly better outcomes than countries led by men. These include leaders like Germany's Angela Merkel, New Zealand's Jacinda Ardern, Denmark's Mette Frederiksen, Taiwan's Chai Ing-wen, and Finland's Sanna Marin. The study confirmed that all the female-led countries locked down earlier and suffered only half as many deaths as countries led by men. The policy responses of the female leaders were more proactive and coordinated. How about performance of female-led companies? There is also here some reliable empirical research. A peer-reviewed research of listed companies on the S&P index from 2000 to 2015 at the Macquarie Business School, and this research was conducted by Dr. Farida Akhtar, showed that companies with female CEOs perform better than companies with male CEOs. And the same goes for companies with a substantial female representation on their boards. Also, Other research shows that Fortune 500 companies with more female directors on their boards have been reported to show a 42% stronger return on sales and a 53% higher return on equity than companies with lesser women on their boards. The findings of the Deloitte study, which I'll mention shortly, also show that companies with female board chairs or CEOs are usually more diverse and more gender balanced than companies with male board chairs and CEOs. So there you have local and international evidence. But unfortunately, our male-dominated world is not giving up its monopoly easily. Deloitte's 2021 Women in the Boardroom report shows that the worldwide average of women on boards is now 19.7%. Only 6.7% are board chairs. Female CEOs across the world are only 4.4%. Nigeria beats the world average by over 3%, which shows clearly that there is positive movement in our male-dominated boardrooms. But women's representation in government positions remains stuck in the past. Only last year, an attempt to pass legislation mandating that women would fill 35% of appointed positions in government and 35% of elected positions generally failed in the National Assembly. The legislators across parties appeared resolutely against the idea. But after considerable local and international criticism, it appears that the matter is being reconsidered by the legislature. And it appears that in every sector, we are going against the empirical and anecdotal currents of opinion. But what can be done? I think important organizations such as yours must step up advocacy for female representation in general as an economic imperative and not a moral duty of men or mere concessions by men. The argument is clear. A country that keeps down half of its productive demography is bound to perform suboptimally. But the issue is not just board representation. It's about representation in politics and government. This is where major decisions affecting our lives are made. But perhaps even more importantly, it's about education of girls. The high levels of female illiteracy is dangerous from all possible standpoints. If half our population is uneducated, it means that development and being competitive in a knowledge-driven world will not happen, or it will happen too slowly to be of much use. Educated women means educated children. And in any event, this is the pipeline for women who will become CEOs, legislators, government officials, and bureaucrats. Female representation must not be reduced to representation by a few elite women who have the good fortune of education. There's a much larger fight for the future of the large majority of girls who are not even represented in primary school figures. We must talk to state governors. The states of the Federation control primary and secondary education, and they must be engaged in the advocacy and persuasion efforts. I think the work of the Women's Directors Committee is well cut out for it. Female representation is the representation of possibly 50% of Nigerians. And as we've seen, perhaps even the smarter half. Our socio-economic future, in so many ways, depends on getting it right. So let me again commend the Institute of Directors, the Women Directors Development Committee, for this insightful and forward-looking conference. I wish you excellent conversations and interactions today. It's now my very special pleasure and privilege to declare open the 2022 Institute of Directors Women Directors Conference. Thank you very much, and God bless you all.